Welcome back. In this video, I would like to talk briefly about the history of programming languages, the diverse categories of programming languages that exist today, as well as the features that characterize each category. Let's start. In 1940, programming was all about using binary code, machine language. A program was a sequence of binary numbers. Engineers put those numbers in the computer memory. They use binary to write the software. These binary numbers represent two main things. First, the ID of a computer instruction, and second, parameters for that instruction. For instance, the programming slide has four instructions with one parameter each. By 1947, the assembly language was born. Engineers created software able to be used to translate words and decimal numbers to binary. This software is called assembler. This is an example of how an assembly language could look like. It is not real, it's used for pedagogical purposes, but you can see the approach. Instructions are strings instead of numeric IDs. LOD is instruction 1, OPR is instruction 2, 10 in binary, and STO is the instruction 3, 11 in binary. And the parameters are represented with decimal numbers. By 1952, engineers figured out that the translation process can be extended to more complex constructs. Therefore, several new languages emerged, called high-level languages. With them, new features emerged, such as variable declaration, procedures, functions, and control structures, conditions and loops. This language requires a program, a compiler, to translate these constructs to assembly language, and the assembler to translate to machine language. For instance, a mathematical expression in a high-level language, such as the one shown in the slide, can be translated to four instructions in assembly language and to a set of binary numbers in machine language. Once that was possible to create this high-level representation, several ideas arise regarding the feature language should have. For instance, would we like to represent the end of the line with a semicolon or with a dot? Would we like to use symbols as operators, such as plus, or words, such as sum? Would we like to use for as a keyword, or repeat, or do? For assignments, do we want the equal symbol, or the arrow? Do we want operators in the middle of operands, or do we want operators first and then operands? Some languages differ in the details, but there are others that fully change the way of thinking. Languages with the same features or characteristics belong to the same paradigm. By definition, a paradigm is a set of assumptions, a way of thinking, or a methodology commonly accepted by members of a group or community. There are several paradigms of programming languages, but there are four that are the most important. In chronological order, imperative languages, object-oriented languages, functional languages, and logic languages. From the first category, we're gonna learn C. From the second category, you already know Java, and we're gonna review C++. As you notice, C++ is in the middle between object-oriented and imperative. C++ have features from both categories. And finally, we're gonna review Lisp as functional language, and Prolog in the category of logic languages. A key idea in C and all the other imperative languages, also called procedural languages, is that the program specifies and manipulates data in a stepwise fashion. To do so, key features in these languages are divide the program into functions or procedures, you know as methods in Java, the use of local and global variables, as well as data structures, and the use of conditionals and loop statements. Imperative languages are ancestors of object-oriented languages, as you can see in the slide. Therefore, all these features are also included in the object-oriented languages. They should be familiar for you. Additionally, the object-oriented paradigm defines a key idea, the encapsulation of data and functionality in classes and objects. Classes and objects introduce new features in programming, such as inheritance, polymorphisms, static and non-static data, and public, private, and protected scope. You already know classes and objects. We are going to review the other features in the following weeks. Functional languages are a little bit different. They evolve in a different path. The key idea of functional languages is that they offer a higher level of abstraction. In particular, that means a simpler semantics. We're going to learn Lisp in order to explore features of this paradigm. But for now, let's take a look to one example. In the first box, you have a function defined in Lisp. In the second box, you have the same function in Java. And one thing that you can notice is that Lisp do not have data types. So there is nothing in the first box that is equivalent to the keyword int. Finally, the key idea in the logic paradigm, also called the declarative paradigm, is that a program is a set of facts, rules, and questions. So there are not data types, no methods, or conditions, or loops. So a program in this paradigm is something like this. The lines in yellow are facts, the lines in red, rules, and the lines in blue, questions. And the lines that start with the percentage symbols are comments. In summary, since 1950, several languages have been developed. Diverse approaches appear. Each approach considers more or less important one feature than others. Key approaches are the imperative or procedural paradigm, the object-oriented paradigm, the functional paradigm, and the logic paradigm. You already know Java, that is an object-oriented language. We will learn one more object-oriented language, one imperative language, one functional language, and one logic language. Our goal is not to be experts on those languages, but be able to compare the features and characteristics of each of them. That's it. So, for this week, your homework. First, go to the discussion board, introduce yourself. Then, read the syllabus and read chapter 1, section 1.1, and then you can go and solve quiz 1. That's it. The only homework this week, the only thing that you submit is quiz 1. But you need to read the syllabus and you need to read the book. Remember that quizzes are 25% of your final grade, so do not forget to submit the quiz 1. Have a great day. Thank you.